Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another in the Institute of Politics speaker series events tonight. My name is Steve Edwards. I'm the executive director here, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's conversation featuring former ABC News Nightline anchor Ted Koppel in conversation with his ABC News colleague and former Nightline correspondent Chris Bury, who's based here in Chicago, and we're thrilled to have both of them here tonight with us for a conversation about Ted's latest book. It's called Lights Out, A Cyberattack, A Nation Unprepared, Surviving the Aftermath. Books will be on sale out here in the lobby in the immediate aftermath, and Ted has been kind enough to agree to sign those books, so we encourage you, if you're interested, to pick up a copy, to please do so after the conclusion of tonight's conversation. As I mentioned, our speaker series goes on throughout the academic year. We have a number of upcoming events this week and next. We have Garry Kasparov coming up on Thursday at noon, talking about politics inside Russia and Putin from his perspective. That'll be at noon on Thursday. Next week, we have a series of events, including a fascinating conversation taking us inside Iranian culture and politics, featuring our very own Marvin Zonis from the university, who's with us here tonight. You'll want to be sure to mark that conversation on your calendar for next Thursday. You can find out about all of these events, as I've mentioned before, on our website. The URL is politics.uchicago.edu. And for students in the audience who are looking for a study break tonight, after tonight's event, we invite the students to come over to the IOP House on Woodlawn for our debate watch party for tonight's Republican presidential debate. So, lots going on at the IOP, and here to officially kick off tonight's program is Maggie Loughran. And Maggie is a student from Pelham, New York. She's here at the university and has most recently been active with the IOP through our Iowa Project. And for those of you who aren't aware of the Iowa Project, it's a program that we supported and created this summer that sent nearly 20 University of Chicago students to Iowa. Half of them were working in the world of politics, on campaigns and field organizations, consulting firms. The other half spent time working for news organizations on the ground. Maggie spent her time at CNN over the course of the summer in the thick of the presidential campaign, and she's returning there along with some other students that we're taking back to Iowa on Saturday for the Des Moines Register-sponsored presidential debate, where they'll be working behind the scenes producing that event. So please join me in welcoming Maggie to the podium to get us started tonight. Maggie?
Good evening, everyone. Ted Koppel is best known for his reign as anchor and managing editor of ABC News' Nightline from 1980 to 2005. His reporting for television's first late-night news program has earned him every major broadcasting award, including 42 Emmys and 8 Peabodys. After leaving ABC, Koppel served as managing editor of the Discovery Channel until 2008. He is currently a senior news analyst for NPR, a contributing analyst to BBC World News America, and a special correspondent for Rock Center. Koppel is also the author of a New York Times bestseller, Off Camera, Private Thoughts Made Public. In his most recent book, Lights Out, A Cyberattack, A Nation Unprepared, Surviving the Aftermath, Koppel explores the implications of what he believes to be an inevitable cyberattack on one of America's three power grids. The federal government may be equipped to handle natural disasters, but it has no plan for the devastation that would result from an extended blackout. How should we prepare, and what can we do to prevent this unique threat to our time? Mr. Koppel will be discussing his book with Chris Bury, a fellow veteran of ABC News. Bury joined ABC in 1982 as a general assignment correspondent based in Chicago. In 1993, he began working as a correspondent on Nightline, where he also served as Mr. Koppel's principal substitute at the anchor desk. Bury is the winner of 6 Emmys and 2 Peabody Awards, and is now a correspondent for Al Jazeera America's America Tonight, host of In the Loop on WYCC here in Chicago, and is the journalist in residence at DePaul University. So with that, Mr. Koppel and Mr. Bury.
Thank you very much. You know, I've been waiting many years to get Koppel right where I want him. answering questions. But welcome to Chicago, my hometown, and the University of Chicago, and thanks everybody for coming out tonight. Your visit is very timely. This is a relic of the 20th century called a newspaper. And on the front page of the Wall Street Journal today is this story. Dateline Kiev, Ukraine. 3 days before Ukraine's presidential vote last year, employees at the National Election Commission arrived at work to find their dowdy Soviet headquarters transformed into the front lines of the hottest cyber wars. Software was destroyed, hard drives were fried, router settings were undone, even the main backup was ruined. Is this the kind of attack that national security officials are worried could take out our power grid or part of it?
Well, it's the kind of cyber war, I think, for openness, Chris, we ought to point out that cyber war is already underway. We do it to them, they do it to us, but there are certain restraints. In other words, when the Chinese government vacuums up 22.1 million records, personnel records, of American officials who work for the Pentagon, who work for the CIA, who work for the FBI, there are several complications. One is, in this day and age, it's always been considered standard operating procedure. We spy on them, they spy on us. Cyber espionage takes it to a whole new level. If you think about 22 million records, the Chinese intelligence agencies can spend the next few years combing through those records with consequences that we cannot even foresee. The kind of attack that the Wall Street Journal is talking about in Ukraine, this kind of thing has been going on already for years. What I'm talking about is a cyber attack against infrastructure, a cyber attack that could affect tens of millions of people for a period of months, if not longer.
But based on your reporting, it seems clear from your book that the national security officials believe that this is a matter of when and not if.
Exactly. In fact, that's a line that a man I came to know when I was embedded with the U.S. forces during the invasion of Iraq, he is now the commander of CENTCOM, four-star general Lloyd Austin, who said exactly that. It's not a question of if, it's only a question of when. One of the reasons that I started doing this book in the first place, Chris, is because I didn't see people paying a whole lot of attention when the president mentioned the danger of a cyber attack on our infrastructure, as he did not once, but twice during successive State of the Union speeches. I didn't see a whole lot of coverage after Leon Panetta said in 2013 in a public speech that he thought we were facing a cyber Pearl Harbor. Now, to the older members of this audience, calling anything a Pearl Harbor has a resonance that hardly any other expression has. I didn't see a whole lot of coverage after Janet Napolitano, who stepped down after nearly 5 years as Secretary of Homeland Security, warned about the danger of a cyber attack on the grid. So initially, my reaction was just one that you and I have had many times. You know, we smell a story there. We don't know exactly what's going to turn out or how we're going to, you know, how the story is going to evolve. But my first goal was just to establish, is this in fact a reality? And I interviewed about 65 people, and while there were a few, really only very few, who said, no, they don't think it's going to happen, the vast majority of people whom I respect said, yes, it is. In fact, Mike Rogers, Admiral Mike Rogers, who is the current director of the NSA, just told a Wall Street Journal conference about 2 weeks ago that it is inevitable, in his opinion, that there will be a cyber attack on our infrastructure.
And even if that isn't scary enough, one of the things that you report is that digital time bombs, sleeper cells, are already implanted in
right.
our grid.
Exactly. It is the conclusion of the NSA. And the NSA is probably the most competent cyber war organization in the world. As great as other nations' cyber offensive capabilities may be, ours are probably still greater. That should not come as a source of great comfort to you, however, because the problem with cyber attacks is that you don't necessarily know where they originated and who was behind them. Think back only to the cyber attack that the North Koreans launched on Sony Pictures.
Now, in revenge for that great movie, The Interview, with
exactly.
Seth Rogen film.
So Seth Rogen makes this goofy movie about a North Korean dictator. It's a pretty silly movie, but obviously the North Korean dictator took offense.
No sense of humor, that guy.
No sense of humor. You would think that concluding the origin of that particular cyber attack would be a cinch. It took the FBI months before they could state with certainty, and I'm not mocking the FBI. I mean, the fact of the matter is, simply because it appears likely that the attack came from North Korea, that's not the kind of thing that a president can act on. They had to prove it. It took months. Now imagine a cyber attack that takes out one of our grids, or a part of one of our grids. We only have three. And as I say, tens of millions of people are affected. And when you talk about affected in this context, think of what it means to be without electricity in our day.
I want to get to that in
a
minute.
Okay.
But first I want to go back to this sleeper cell, because you had a conversation in your reporting with George Cotter, who is the former chief scientist for the National Security Agency, the NSA. And he told you that China and Russia
already have.
Are already in the grid.
They're already in the grid, and they have what amount to time bombs, grenades, mines, however you want to refer to them, but cyber time bombs or cyber mines, which can, in effect, be activated with the stroke of a laptop key.
Is it fair to assume we have the same capability that we probably have sleeper cells in the Chinese grid, in the Russian grid, the Iranian?
Absolutely. Let's separate the notion of these time bombs and the sleeper cells. Really two different things. The time bombs, I don't want to leave you with the impression that any high school hacker can get into the grid. It is enormously complex. And intelligence agencies from our adversaries have been spending years mapping the grid so that they can determine how to do maximum damage. We know, I say, because the former chief scientist of the NSA told me this, as did Keith Alexander, his boss, who was the director of NSA, we know that the Russians are in the grid, we know that the Chinese are in the grid. That's actually not as alarming as you may think, because we have so many interlocking relationships with both the Chinese and the Russians that it is most unlikely that they will hit the key. It would, after all, be nothing less than an act of war. The problem is, and Chris made reference to it a moment ago, these teams of, in effect, agents who are skilled in cyber warfare, who have been dispersed by the Russian government, quite literally all around the world, who are in a position to launch cyber attacks, have the knowledge, the wherewithal, simply waiting for a directive. Think about it for a moment. It's very, very difficult, bordering sometimes on the next to impossible, to determine the point of origin of a cyber attack. The initial indication appears to be it came from Ukraine. Then the NSA looks into it a little bit further and says, no, it actually looks like before Ukraine, it came from Buenos Aires. Wait a second. Before Buenos Aires, it came from Copenhagen. Before Copenhagen, it came from Johannesburg. Before Johannesburg, and this appears to be, we think we've tagged it now, the point of origin is Brooklyn. Really? Who did it? Who ordered it? You know, a president can respond to missiles that are coming from Russia or China. He knows the point of origin. The Chinese know, the Russians know that the president knows where the attack is coming from and that a counterattack is going to happen within a matter of minutes. That's what created mutual assured destruction, the balance of terror.
That doesn't work with cyber. Mutual assured destruction is not a disincentive for others.
Exactly. Quite the contrary. It is an incentive. I mean, one of the ironies of this nuclear deal we've made with Iran is that the great danger from Iran is not a nuclear attack. I mean, the Iranians would be absolutely insane to engage the United States in a nuclear war. They would lose that in a matter of hours. But cyber attacks originating in Iran, or at least ordered by Iran and originating elsewhere, that's something else again. So here's the curious situation. The ones who have the greatest capability, the Chinese and the Russians, least likely to do it because we have so many interlocking relations with them. Not so much with Iran. Their capability is almost equal to that of China and Russia. We don't have that many interlocking relationships with them. As you go down the capability scale, North Korea, not as capable as Iran, but capable of doing real damage. Do they have a lot to worry about? Think only of those photographs you've seen of the Korean Peninsula at night. Below the DMZ, lit up like a Christmas tree. Above the DMZ, effectively dark. They don't have an infrastructure. They are not vulnerable to attack. The paradox is that we, because we are such a dependent society on the internet, we are more vulnerable to cyber attack than probably any country in the world.
You also mentioned in your book that one of those players is Syria.
Yes.
And you go so far as to suggest that American foreign policy may have very well been impacted by our knowledge of the Syrian capabilities.
At the time that the president was considering the possibility of an attack on Syria. You remember when it was determined that they had chemical weapons and the president had warned this was a red line they must not cross. They crossed it. The president did nothing. George Cotter, again the former chief scientist of the NSA, told me that at that time there were Syrian cyber attacks launched against banks in New York. Definitive conclusions cannot be reached, but simply look at what was out there. The Syrians were clearly sending a message. We can cause you enormous damage. We can create huge upset in your financial markets. Better not launch those attacks against Syria. Was that the reason that we didn't? I don't know. But those, at least, are the facts that existed at the time.
So we've talked about these potential enemies, so far state actors, Syria, Iran, North Korea, China, Russia. We've just in the last week heard from our intelligence community pretty definitively that a Russian airliner was brought down by a bomb, presumably from ISIS. Are these non-state actors, the terrorist organizations, are these the kind of groups that could get the capability to take down the grid?
In short, yes. Probably don't have the capability yet, although I was told by a former cyber advisor to the White House that it's his belief that indeed organizations like ISIS, even if they themselves don't have the expertise, they have a couple of $1 billion. You can buy a lot of expertise for a couple of $1 billion. And the equipment that's needed to do this, unlike, again, I mean, what's so different about cyber warfare is you don't need an army, you don't need a navy, you don't need an air force, you don't need missiles. You need the knowledge to be able to launch an attack like this, and you need a laptop computer. It can be done by an individual anywhere in the world. Is it almost inevitable that ISIS, if it doesn't have the capability now, will get it at some time in the not too distant future? Apparently, yes. And when you talk about interlocking interests, we in ISIS have none. So there are no inhibitions on a group like ISIS to do something like this. They, after all, their strategy, if it can be described as such, is nothing more or less than inflicting pain and causing damage. That would inflict a lot of pain. That would cause a lot of damage.
You've got a lot of scary quotes in this book, enough to keep people up late at night. But one of the scariest ones, to me anyway, came from the former director of national intelligence. We used to call him the CIA director, Mike McConnell. And it was relayed to you from Jay Rockefeller, the former chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. And the quote was from, this is from Mike McConnell, "For the record, if we were attacked, we would lose." Does your reporting convince you that that sentiment is pretty well shared by the intelligence community?
Yes, and let me, you know, let me presume to explain what I think Director McConnell was talking about. I made reference to it or an allusion to it a moment ago. We are so dependent on the internet in this country, as dependent as any great power out there, probably more dependent than most. The internet was never designed to be defended. The people who created the internet in the first place assumed, as one military intelligence officer told me, that it was going to be used by professors to exchange good ideas. The notion that someday you would have to defend the internet against a hacking attack, when it was created, nobody even knew what a hacking attack was. It was not a concept that was out there. So here we are in a situation where, arguably, because of our dependence on the internet and because of the many, many uses to which we put it, we're more vulnerable than anybody else out there. Do we have a terrific cyber offensive capability? Yes, we do. And if we know who has attacked us, and if they also are vulnerable to cyber attack, we can do a hell of a job.
Well, one of the ironies that you point out is that as the United States was the first country to launch a nuclear attack, we were also the first nation to launch a very sophisticated cyber attack.
On the Iranians. We and the Israelis, and ironically, I'm told, the reason that we collaborated with the Israelis on launching the cyber attack is we felt that Israel was dangerously close to launching an offensive attack against Iran, that the Israelis were dangerously close to attacking Iran because of its growing nuclear capability. To stop Israel or to discourage Israel from doing that, our NSA and the Israeli equivalent collaborated on developing a program called Stuxnet. Stuxnet was used, I always have trouble, what are the spinning?
Centrifuges.
The centrifuges, thank you. Stuxnet was developed, those centrifuges which spin the nuclear fuel have to spin at precisely the right number of revolutions per minute or per second. Let's say it's 2,000 revolutions a minute. If they spin too fast or spin too slow, you throw the whole program off kilter. We and the Israelis managed to implant a virus in the program that caused these centrifuges to spin out of control. What we also did that is close to genius, but was apparently borrowed from the Hollywood movie Ocean's 11.
We faked them out, right?
Faked them out. Created a video that somehow we managed to implant in the Natanz control room. It showed the spinning going exactly as intended, so that the Iranian technicians sitting at the control board would be looking up and saying, everything okay here?
No bank heist.
Right. Meanwhile, the centrifuges were spinning out of control. The Iranian program was set back about a year and a half or 2 years. And Iran did respond. The point that, Chris is making is we fired the first shot in real cyber war.
And Iran didn't retaliate against us.
They didn't retaliate against us or against the Israelis because apparently they didn't want this to turn into an escalating cyber war. They did retaliate against Aramco.
Which
is an Arab-American oil company based in Saudi Arabia. And what they did is they launched a cyber attack, a hacking attack, and knocked out 30,000 computers. In other words, every computer that Aramco was using showed a video of a burning American flag. But they were, as one officer told me, essentially 30,000 bricks. They were useless. So that was the first cyber battle, if you will. We knocked their centrifuges off balance. They came back at Aramco. And here we are now confronting all kinds of incredible potential for cyber war being raised several notches.
Help us understand why it is that our electrical grid is so vulnerable. What is it about? Why isn't it better protected?
The power grid used to be made up of relatively few companies, and they were vertically integrated, which means that the companies would generate the power, they would transmit the power across the country, and then they would download the power at local places to our places of business and our residences. A number of years ago, the electric power industry was deregulated. There are now 3,200 electric power companies out there. In order for them to be able to interact with one another, in order for them to be able to function, they require the internet. They require what are called SCADA systems, supervisory control and data acquisition. I'm gonna bore you for a minute or so with a little bit of wonkiness here, but you need to understand how the system works. Imagine a giant balloon that has 1,000 valves. 500 of those valves take air in, 500 of those valves release air out. As long as the amount of air coming in and the amount of air going out is exactly the same, the balloon remains perfectly inflated. Too much air, balloon bursts. Too little air, balloon collapses. Our power grid depends upon maintaining a perfect balance between the amount of electricity that is generated and the amount of electricity that is used. There is only one operating system, and that is the internet, that is capable of maintaining that excruciatingly fine balance among 3,200 different companies. That's that SCADA system that I was talking about a moment ago. If a hacker can somehow get into that SCADA system and throw it out of balance so that more power is being generated, let's say, than is being used, you would get a cascading effect that can take out all or part of a grid.
What kind of power or control or authority does the federal government have over these 3,000 plus little power companies?
Yeah, surprisingly little. Let me just tell you that FERC, which is the federal agency that allegedly has power over the power industry, FERC has to propose legislation or rules to the power industry. The power industry then gets to vote on whether it wants to accept those regulations.
Funny how that works.
Unless 60% of the power industry approves the regulations, they don't go into effect. So here we have an industry that has the right to determine which regulations on its operation it is prepared to accept. This is hardly the federal government controlling the power industry. It's the power industry controlling what the federal government can enforce. Having said that, it also, at the delivery point, again, gets a little wonky here, but power, when it's generated, you have these step-up transformers, which increase the wattage, or the voltage, rather, so that the electricity is sent across the country at high speeds. Then when it gets to its location, there are step-down transformers that enable the electricity to be delivered to your home, to your place of business. There is no federal regulation, none, that is operative from that final point where the electricity is stepped down and actually delivered to your home. Forget about your home for a moment. The electricity that is delivered to the CIA is not under federal regulations. The electricity that is delivered to the NSA is not under federal regulations. It's an incredible situation, but you know, part of our biggest problem is our own system.
And as much as the intelligence officials seemed to have a consensus on the dangers here, from what I gather with your interviews with the power company executives,
right,
there are quite a few who think that these concerns are overblown.
Yes, they do. And I mean, Chris, you and I have been reporters all our lives. At a certain point, you come to a, you know, forgive me, it's, we learn to separate shit from shinola. And I must tell you that in the final analysis, I came, you know, we all have to reach a conclusion at some point or another. When you read the book or when you get other information on the subject, you may reach a different conclusion. I am convinced that this can happen, and I am more or less convinced that at some point or another, it's going to happen in one form or another.
It seems from your reporting that in some form, it already has happened. I mean, you cite a very interesting attack on a substation that serves San Jose, California,
yes,
the Silicon Valley, which requires enormous power. 2013, a substation was taken out by an armed group. And
yeah,
this is something that, although the Wall Street Journal has done a fair amount of reporting, very little is known about this.
To this day, the FBI doesn't know exactly who was responsible. This has nothing to do, parenthetically, with cyber war. What happened here is that a group of people, we don't know how many, went to the Metcalf substation, a substation of PG&E, and using what a SEAL team later determined was AK-47s, shot out 17 or 19 large power transformers. These large power transformers are among the most vulnerable things we have in our electric power system. There are thousands of them, maybe tens of thousands, but they are gigantic, 400,000 to 600,000 pounds each. Each one costs about $10 million, and each one is custom made, so that you cannot just take a large power transformer that Chris happens to own. I mean, he can't just send it over to my power company and say, here, I understand yours were shot out, use mine. They're not interchangeable. And here's the worst news of all. Very few of them are made here in the United States. They're almost all made, about 75 or 80% of them, are made overseas. How long does it take from the time that you order a new large power transformer until delivery? 1 to 2 years, right? So here is a situation where 17 of these large power transformers were shot out. The only conclusion that the FBI has reached to date is that this may have been a
dry run?
I'm sorry?
A dry run?
A dry run. It may have been an exercise. Because
but they have no clue who did it.
I'm sorry?
They have no clue.
Not a clue.
Wow.
Not a clue. And it's been 2.5 years. And we still don't know who did it. You know, if you knocked out enough of these transformers over a fairly wide geographic area, they were able to get online again very quickly, because they were able to transfer power to another generating station nearby. As it was, this particular station was knocked out, I forget, I think it was 17 days. Not too terrible. And indeed, the power companies will say, see, we were able to get back online again. But if this was only a dry run, and if the real operation that someone is planning is to hit half a dozen of these substations at the same time, again, the impact could be devastating.
What about the giant companies in the Silicon Valley, Apple, Google, Facebook? Do they have their own generation, or do they rely on this grid?
They rely on the grid. I'm sure they have their own emergency generators. And again, with emergency generators, you can keep power going for quite a while. I have two emergency generators at my home. They operate on natural gas, which comes in automatic. One little problem. The natural gas comes from Texas. It is driven through pipes, right, by motors.
Of course, yeah.
Those motors are run on, oh shoot, they're run by electricity. So my emergency power generators are probably going to shut down at some point, really fairly soon after a cyber attack like this. On the other hand, I could have one operating on diesel fuel, but then I'd have to bury a 1,000-gallon tank to be sure that I have enough diesel fuel. There are major problems. I mean, what happened after Superstorm Sandy in New York? The gas stations had plenty of gasoline. It was all down there in those tanks. Unfortunately, they didn't have any emergency generators, and the power was out, so they couldn't pump the gas. That's a problem. So what the state of New York had to do was to provide generators to all of these gas stations. I went to my local gas station in Potomac, Maryland. I've known the owner for 40 years. I said, Mike, do you have an emergency generator? And he said, no. I said, why not? He said, well, it costs $40,000. I'm not going to spend $40,000 on that. I said, but if the power goes out, you won't be able to pump gas. He said, well, I'll be out of work. That's it. But my lease is only good for another 7 years, and I cannot afford to spend $40,000. I'll never make that $40,000 back over the next 7 years. So he's rolling the dice that it's not going to happen.
I remember one day in Washington, might have been 2007, 2008, when power went out on the East Coast. You were called in, and you were like iron pants that day. You were on the air for ABC News for, I don't know, eight or 10 hours.
Yeah.
35 million people were without electricity for several days. Is that kind of a taste of what we might expect, what the East Coast saw in those few days?
Yeah. Here's something else you may want to think about. So let's say the power goes out in New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, Delaware. Now you've got several tens of millions of people without power. There is an inadequate food supply because, for example, the state of New York, I talked to the head of Homeland Security for the state of New York, and I said, how much emergency food do you have? Oh, he said, we have 25 million MREs. Wow, 25 million. I said, now, city of New York alone, five boroughs, you've had 8 million people, so 8 into 25, you got about 3 meals per person, right? So after 2 or 3 days, you're out of food. He said, right. I said, what do you do then? He said, then we're in deep trouble. Here's the problem. You got tens of millions of people without electricity, without light, without power, without the capability to turn on a tap and get water, without the ability to flush your toilet. So in a place like New York or Chicago, how long do you think it's going to be before the inability to get rid of human waste becomes a health problem? And people say, I know what I'll do. I'm going to hop in my car, and I'm going to drive to the nearest state where the lights are still on. You are assuming that you will be welcome. We're all Americans, right? You may not be. I spoke to an official of one state that is a rural state, only a few hours drive from Washington, who told me that the governor had they did sort of a war game, and they have told the National Guard, the state police, the local sheriff's departments, that what they're going to be doing in the event of something like this and tens of thousands of refugees coming from Washington, they will be handed a bottle of water, a sandwich, and a map. And the map will show them where the nearest gas station is. And they will be told, I'm terribly sorry, we do not have the infrastructure to support tens of thousands of refugees.
Even before we get to that point, in a city like Chicago, or New York, where a lot of people like me live in high rises, the elevators are going to go out.
Yes. The first thing that will happen, the first thing that does happen when the power goes out, the first thing that happened when Superstorm Sandy hit is the emergency personnel, their first job is getting everybody out of stalled elevators, right? That's the easy part. From there on in, it gets really nasty. Remember, we are a nation of 300 million guns. At a time like this, when people are hungry, and folks in rural areas may have a freezer full of venison or not, but you know, it's more likely that people in the countryside are simply more accustomed to handling bad weather, being able to get through. And I'm not suggesting that you have to have MREs or freeze-dried food. You know, if you live in a place where space is not an issue, a 50-pound sack of rice and a 50-pound sack of black beans will do you very nicely.
But in the meantime, what's the federal plan? When you talk to Homeland Security, you talk to FEMA, they certainly have thought this through, right? They've got a plan?
No, they do not. They have plans for every natural disaster under the sun. They have plans for earthquakes, they have plans for hurricanes, they have plans for snowstorms, blizzards, drought, they have all kinds of plans. But every one of those plans, with the possible exception of the earthquake, involves the recommendation that we have a 2 to 3 day supply of food and water, that we have extra medicine that will take us over that 2 to 3 day period, that we have a radio with fresh batteries, a flashlight, and a plan so that if the family is separated when the crisis hits, that we'll know where to meet them.
A couple of granola bars and we're all set. But if the federal government...
Well, let me just finish, Chris, because, you know, when I pressed the current Secretary of Homeland Security and said, that's fine, but that's 2 or 3 days. If you're dealing with a cyber attack, we're talking about weeks, maybe months. What is the plan? And he and I did not hit it off. And he was pointing over his shoulder to a shelf that had several white binders on it. And he said, I'm sure there's a plan up there somewhere. If the plan is that they're only going to tell us about it after the power goes out, think about it for a moment. That's sort of counterintuitive, isn't it? I mean, first of all, the time to tell us about it is when all of our means of communication are still functioning. Those cell phones we use every day, they're going to be out of power in a day and a half. Mine is usually shot after one day. The phones, not going to be working. Your banks, going to be closed down. Cash machines, not functioning. And food, running out.
During Katrina, you famously had Michael Brown, the head of FEMA, on the show. I was down in New Orleans basically reporting on bodies being stacked up at the convention center. And Brown told you everything was hunky-dory. And Bush, I think, said something like, attaboy, Brownie, or something like that.
Nice job, Brownie.
Nice job, Brownie.
Yeah.
But at any rate, do you, based on your reporting, have any confidence that should we experience an attack like this, that FEMA is any better equipped to handle it than they were at Katrina?
Much better. I mean, first of all, the current administrator of FEMA is a man by the name of Craig Fugate. Fugate is a terrific disaster specialist. And when I asked Fugate, what's the plan? He was very candid about it. He said, I mean, first of all, we would get emergency generators. You've got to get water in. You've got to get emergency generators into as many of these cities as you can, primarily for the purpose of keeping the toilets flushing so that we don't have the health crisis of human waste building up. But when I said, what would you do in the event of a cyber attack where we're talking about not a few days, but weeks or months without power? And he said, effectively, my job and FEMA's job is going to be keeping the number of dead down to a manageable level. That was about as honest an answer as I got from any official in government.
So if the government is really not prepared, you did find somebody who is.
The Mormons.
The Mormons.
The Mormons are prepared. And in large measure, they are prepared because the Mormons have a history. In fact, those of you here in Illinois may remember that there was a Mormon city not too far from here that in the middle of the 19th century was effectively the size of Chicago. Mormons had a huge presence here in Illinois at one point. They also previously had a presence in Missouri, and a presence in Pennsylvania, and a presence in New York State, where the religion began. But they kept being driven from one state to another. And it was sort of ingrained in Mormon culture that you have to be prepared for bad times. You have to be prepared for disaster. Essentially, all Mormon families are encouraged to have a 3 to 6 month supply of food at home. And many, if not most, do. The Mormon church as a whole, the institution, has created an absolutely mind-boggling backlog and continual production of food and necessary supplies. I spent 3 days out in Salt Lake City because they insisted the only way I could really understand what they've got is to come out and look at it. And they were right. It was the right thing to do. The Mormons are prepared. I spend 3 chapters in the book on the Mormons because I think all of us can learn something.
Are they going to help us out? Are they going to share a sandwich?
You know something? It's fascinating because I raised that question.
If you're gay?
Huh?
What if you're gay?
I raised the question with individual Mormon families and got some heartbreaking responses. I mean, people saying, I remember one woman in Cody, Wyoming, saying to me, if hungry people came to my door and I have food, I have to share it. And I turned to her husband, and he said, look, this is, we believe that this is not the only life there is. We believe that there is a life with Heavenly Father, and I'm going to be judged on how I respond to situations like that here and now. When I tried to get leadership in the Mormon church to tell me what they would do, because it is maybe not as well known now as it will be when people read the book, but the understanding that Mormons have these warehouses, collections of warehouses that would put Walmart and Costco to shame, enough food and enough materiel to maintain probably most, if not all, of the 6 million Mormons in this country. Would they share it with the rest of us? At that point, my guess is probably not.
So the lessons, you said that you've got a generator, right? You've got water. What else have you done? Have you become what they call, or you call, a prepper?
A prepper. I mean, it's not a term that I came up with. Preppers. We're familiar with survivalists. We're familiar with the image of people who've built themselves a bunker, who have a machine gun sort of standing on the sandbags, and who are waiting for the black UN helicopters to show up. These folks are not the preppers. The preppers, for the most part, are sensible men and women who simply are concerned that the federal government is not going to take care of them in the event of an emergency. And some of them have gone to, I mean, there are programs on television that are really silly, and they are there more for the entertainment than anything else, focusing on preppers. Most preppers that I've met tend to be fairly sensible people who have prepared for at least a few weeks without any kind of food that they can buy from the store or expecting any help from the government.
One conservative website called Newsbusters was taking a little fun at your expense.
And sure.
Recent headline, has Ted Koppel become a right-wing survivalist?
I saw that.
And great quote here, it now appears that Ted Koppel is wearing a tinfoil hat, I don't see it here, because he is warning us about a possible apocalyptic catastrophe.
Yeah.
So you're not wearing the hat, but are you trying to scare us here?
Yes. I think there are times when, you know, in the final analysis, all of us, Chris, I mean, you've had occasion to make decisions like this also. In our system of government, in our culture, we at least used to believe, even though it may be slipping a little bit, that the job of the media is to tell us, in addition to the wonderful things that are going on, to warn us about bad things that may be developing. I would feel an awful lot worse if I decided, no, this is going to cause too much upset. I'm not going to tell people what I've learned. How would I feel a few months from now if something like this happens and I knew by alerting people I could have saved even a few lives? It's not my job ultimately to tell you whether to act on what I'm telling you or not act on what I'm telling you. My job is to say, look, I did a year and a half of reporting and writing. I talked to the smartest people I could find who know as much about this subject as I could possibly gather. And my conclusion is it's very likely that this is going to happen. Now, you do whatever you want. Ironically, to use the term right-wing survivalist, this is an issue that should not divide us on a partisan basis. This is not a conservative issue. This is not a liberal issue. Democrats and Republicans ought to be responding to this in the same fashion.
If you
don't believe it, that's fine. That's your option.
That raises a point that I want to end on before I invite the audience to come in, and that is you write somewhat wistfully in your book about a different era when journalism and both parties in Washington shared what you had some shared civic values. That's obviously disintegrated with the partisanship that we've seen in the media and in Washington. My final question for you is, what does the loss of those shared values mean for, you know, any meaningful discussion on an issue like this, let alone action?
It's devastating. It's devastating. The late, great U.S. Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan used to say, everyone is entitled to his own opinion. He's not entitled to his own facts. We live in an era in which people quite literally are making up their own facts. People on the right are doing it. People on the left are doing it. I make reference in the book to the fact that in a survey that was conducted among a lot of people, more than 1,000 people, the question was asked, and it was put this way, are you sure that President Obama was born outside the United States? And I believe it was 37% of the respondents said, yes, I'm sure he was born outside the United States. Give me a break. I mean, some things are just stupid. Some things are just insane, but because we have so much partisanship in our media these days, and particularly on the web, because there are so many blogs out there that take a position that is extreme in one direction or another, and I'm not pointing the fingers at either the right or the left. To a certain degree, they're equally culpable. We have to get back to a point in this country where objectivity and seeking the facts is considered a worthwhile career. And I realize that, Rupert Murdoch, when he created Fox, was responding to a perception that people like Chris and me were part of a media that, for the most part, was too liberal, and that there was a need for a conservative counterbalancing. And Fox has certainly done that. But I think we've gone too far. We need to get back to a day when we can actually, how wistful, you talk about wistfulness. Think about the fact that Walter Cronkite at one point was the most trusted man in America. Imagine the suggestion that a journalist today would be accepted by people on the right and people on the left as being the most trusted man or woman in America. Ain't gonna happen, not anymore. But that's our loss.
On that eloquent note, we'd like to invite some questioners, and the first few we'd like from students from UFC, so please come on up to
there's
the microphone.
There's a microphone over there if you want to go to it.
Hi, thank you for coming today. It seemed like a lot of your solutions that you were talking about were for mitigating the results of this problem. Is there truly no chance at prevention? Are government officials looking towards more analog backup methods if a cyber attack were to occur? Or is it more of, we just need to prepare for ourselves?
No, it's a terrific question. Unfortunately, because of the deregulation of the power industry, analog isn't going to work anymore. You need the internet to maintain that exquisite balance I was talking about with production of electricity and consumption of electricity. And because there are now 3,200 individual companies, and they all have to be connected, and decisions need to be made at the speed of light as to how much electricity to bring in and how much electricity to send out, going back to the analog system is probably not an option. Not that I think the power industry would permit that to happen. Can we look forward to the development of more microgrids, for example, which are cropping up all over the United States? Yes, we can. Are there going to be options that smart people are working on? And there are, and I write about some of them in Lights Out. But can any of these measures be completed before something like this is going to happen? Almost certainly not.
Great question.
You mentioned before that if our country is faced with a cyber attack, we have the potential to launch a retaliatory cyber attack if you know where it came from.
Yeah.
But do you ever envision that if we're faced with a cyber attack that might lead to actual physical warfare?
I'm sorry?
That if we're faced with a cyber attack, it might lead to an actual physical warfare?
Oh, of course. Of course, absolutely. But, whether the response comes in the form of a cyber counterattack, or whether we send the Marines, or whether we launch a nuclear missile, you still have to know where the attack came from. And the great danger in cyber warfare is we almost certainly will not know that immediately, and it may be weeks or months before we can say with certainty. Put yourself in the position of the president, whoever that happens to be, who looks at the consequences of this attack and asks his intelligence people, can you tell me where it came from? And they're saying, well, we can say with 37% certainty that it came from the Russians were behind it. And if you're the president, you're going to say, wait a second, you expect me to launch a counterattack based on 37% certainty? I can't do that.
Hello, thank you for coming. I'm a student at the Harris School, and I'm taking a class in cybersecurity right now, and we've learned about something called the 20 critical controls. And apparently a lot of cyber issues come down to very easy hacks that are kind of widespread and we could control if we just had better hygiene in most of our systems. So I'm wondering, in terms of the systems that provide access to the systems that are providing us energy, the grid, so all of the connected places where a hack could come from, do you think that there's a solution in kind of optimizing all of those entry points with just basic hygiene, which would probably account for like 80% of the possibility of getting it hacked? Or is that like infeasible because of political and other reasons?
No. It's a terrific question. And think about the word you're using, hygiene. And then think about how many words in cybersecurity are borrowed from medicine. So we talk about a virus. We talk about exercising hygiene. Here's one of the problems. The big companies, the ones with lots of money, set up Sony Pictures, for example, in one Wall Street Journal story. They came to the conclusion Sony Pictures had 43 firewalls. 42 of them were run by outside companies. One of them, the outside company, had been dropped, and Sony had taken over the firewall itself. The conclusion that the Wall Street Journal reached was that that was the point of entry. Imagine you've got these power companies that have every possible cybersecurity measure that money can buy. Jamie Dimon, the head of JP Morgan Chase, told me that his company, by this time, has probably spent close to $1 billion on cybersecurity. Here's the problem. Some guy or gal takes their thumb drive home and plugs it into his or her personal computer. And it is infected, right? He takes that thumb drive back to work, shoves it into his work laptop, and the system is infected. I draw an analogy to what happened when the Ebola virus was the great threat, the great fear, and this man came to Texas from West Africa and he had the Ebola virus and he was being cared for by two nurses. He was in the final stages of the Ebola disease, projectile vomiting, terrible diarrhea. The nurses had on headgear, plastic visor, two outer coverings, right? Two sets of gloves, two sets of booties. And yet, somehow they became infected. And the conclusion that the medical experts reached was either there was a tiny little spot on their necks that was still exposed, or that when they were taking their gloves off, they touched with their bare hands the outside of one of the gloves and became infected that way. If you keep that in mind and you realize how the tiniest little error can lead to catching a virus, you begin to understand how the tiniest little error on the part of an employee can take a corporation that really is protected in every feasible way can take them down.
Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. My question might sound a little bit futuristic. So you just mentioned that China and the US have mutually assured destruction in the cyber attack.
No, I didn't say that.
You didn't say that?
On the contrary. And what I said was they have so many thousands of interlocking interests. We have commercial interests in common with China. We send exports to them, they send exports to us. There are so many things that link us that we will do everything we can to avoid any kind of war, including cyber war. So I gave you the impression that I think
and you talk about possibly ISIS gonna have the capability to conduct cyber attack. Is there any possibility that those big country, big power, cooperate in this cyber defense, like China and the US, and what would be the hurdles, and what would be some of the possibilities that they're gonna come together and?
Yeah, well, let me offer you one hurdle. I told you a moment ago about the Chinese vacuuming up 22.1 million personnel records of former and current members of the CIA and the FBI. China denies that, denies that they did it. You know, you're going to have some problems in credibility on both sides. It's, I mean, first of all, the interesting thing to me was that the head of the NSA said, in effect, nice job. I mean, I wish we'd been able to pull off that kind of an intelligence coup. They're sitting there with 22 million records of, I mean, they're going to be sifting through those records for years. It's probably the biggest intelligence coup in the history of mankind. But we can't even get the Chinese to admit that they did it. They refuse to admit it. So, you know, what makes you think that we're going to be able to collaborate on going after, I mean, we are probably going to be collaborating with the Russians and with the Iranians in terms of going after ISIS kinetically. Are we going to do that in the world of cyber warfare? I don't think ISIS is really vulnerable to cyber attack. What's their infrastructure? They don't have much of one, right? That's the problem. Weakness in this case is a strength, whereas our strength in terms of our cyber dependence is a weakness.
Yeah, if your account is really urgent and that would incentivize like the US and China to cooperate to defend against this cyber attack. So if your story is really true and really urgent, there must be some incentive to dispel this credibility issue. You know, President Xi visited US recently, and he was asked a question about is there any cyber attack sponsored by the government? He said no.
Right.
It's all individuals.
Exactly.
Doing that. So if your story is
individuals
really true,
who happen to be in the Chinese army. Yes.
Yeah. So.
Well, I mean, Chris's point is a valid point. You know, the NSA proved conclusively, at least to our satisfaction, that these attacks were originating from buildings, I believe, in Shanghai, that are run by the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, and where the PLA cybersecurity units are housed. How do you begin to establish an environment of trust between two governments when clearly, and I'm not even just going to put it on the Chinese, I'm sure we lie to the Chinese as much as the Chinese lie to us.
Shocking.
It is shocking indeed. Can we collaborate to the point of, it clearly is important, and as you say, President Xi and President Obama acknowledge publicly that finding some modus vivendi on cyber war is an essential matter that has to be confronted by the Chinese government and the US government. In the final analysis, would I be confident that China will never launch another cyber attack against us, or that we will never launch another cyber attack against them? Not a chance.
We have to go to the next question. Thank you.
Let me first say it's such a pleasure to hear your distinctive voice again.
Thank you.
Two quick questions. The first question is, as you did your research, you mentioned that the president talked about this issue in his State of the Union address. I'm sure other presidents.
Two State of the Union addresses.
I'm sure other presidents have talked about it in the past and different things.
Perhaps. I don't think so, actually.
Think so. Okay.
Maybe they have, but I'm not aware of it.
If the president brought it up twice in a State of the Union address, how come there hasn't been any action to create a plan or to buy additional backup generators for that eventuality? Or why isn't there more action? Why are we at this phase that you're writing a book saying nobody's done anything?
Well, okay, if I've left you with the impression that nobody has done anything, I've misled you. I do want to leave you with the impression that there is no plan for the American civilian population after a major cyber attack. Are there plans and are there actions being taken to mitigate, to defend the power grid? For example, they've come up with, you know those little tires you have in the backs of some cars that if you have a flat, you can put it on the wheel and it'll take you for 50 miles. You can't go far. They have developed sort of little mini generators that can serve to keep things going for a little while if one of the big generators is knocked out. But it's a Band-Aid. They have developed programs for collaboration between industry and the NSA, for example, and the Department of Homeland Security. The Senate just passed cybersecurity legislation after years of it being blocked by the Chamber of Commerce, really acting in behalf of the power industry. But this new legislation calls for privacy concerns to be taken into account. So before an electric power company can be required to hand over information on a suspected attack, they have the right to scrub that material of privacy concerns. Then instead of giving it directly to the NSA, which is the most competent agency to deal with these kinds of things, they are under this legislation required to give it to the least competent agency, the Department of Homeland Security.
TSA. Great.
Well, TSA, they won't give it to TSA. Department of Homeland Security has its own problems. The Washington Post every year does a feature on Department of Homeland Security citing the findings of a company that measures, among thousands of interviews, those federal agencies that have the highest morale, lowest morale, highest efficiency, lowest efficiency. It will come as no great comfort to you when I tell you that the Department of Homeland Security, out of 19 agencies, comes in 19th in almost every category. It comes in 18th in one category. It is a terribly mismanaged and really misconceived agency.
That's reassuring. Could we have one more question? And then
the second part of that is, I'm sure it came up in your research, but you didn't talk about nuclear power this evening. We're coming up on near the fifth anniversary of the Fukushima disaster.
Right.
The majority, there's many nuclear power plants that are built on earthquake faults on the West Coast. We have many that are on the shores of the Great Lakes here. They're near the end of their useful life. During your research, what did you find out about nuclear power, and what are your thoughts on the issues?
Well, for example, there's a three-star general. You're talking about, you know, solutions that people are trying to come up with. A retired three-star general is collaborating with some other people to try to convince the government that we need to take some of the nuclear generators, the small nuclear generators that have for more than 50 years now been used aboard U.S. Navy ships and submarines, and put them on military bases. Over 50 years, these generators have been operating without a single accident, without a single incident. They want to have generators, nuclear generators like this, put on military bases around the United States so that those military bases, at least, will be independent in terms of generating power, and indeed will generate enough power to be able to share power with the neighboring community. I asked the general, if the president tomorrow were to say, absolutely, great idea, do it, how long would it take? 10 years. That's part of the problem with some of the solutions that people are working on. Yes, they're working on a lot of solutions, but it'll be years before they are really operating.
Last questioner.
Hi, I came in a little late working. But in 2003, I witnessed foreign nationals being given access to critical infrastructure at ComEd Exelon. You have the hundreds of American IT workers being laid off at Southern California Edison and replaced by mostly Indian H-1B L-1 visas. You have baggage handlers, according to Woolsey CIA, being brought in on H-2B, probably H-2B visas, access to critical infrastructure. During your research, did anybody express concern that all these foreign nationals, including the OPT extension that Obama just decreed?
I'm sorry, what's the OPT?
OPT, Optional Practical Training. It's a program decreed through Department of Homeland Security to allow foreign nationals, originally 12 months, now they can stay 41 months, working in disciplines related to cybersecurity, space defense. This is under the SEVIS list you can get off of ICE. It's about 12 pages long. Critical, sensitive military technology that foreign nationals who graduated from graduate school or undergrad, probably graduate school, can continue to work in these disciplines. What I'm talking about is foreign nationals' access to critical infrastructure not being vetted. Did anyone express concern about that? We're talking about tens of thousands of people. I'm not talking about just Win Ho Lee, but I guess the power companies. The highest per capita of H-1B is in Washington, D.C. So that's my question to you.
And my straightforward answer has to be no one talked to me about that. And it may well be a matter of critical concern. I sort of cringe a little bit whenever it's put in terms of thousands of people, of whom thousands of people are probably doing a wonderful and very loyal and decent job. Is it possible that foreign governments have been able to sneak somebody in under that program? It's entirely possible, but if the response to that is going to be, we can't take people whose place of birth was outside the United States, I'm in trouble. I was born
American
in England.
Citizens were just laid off at Southern California Edison and replaced by foreign workers. This just happened in the last year and a half. Hundreds, just at that one company, and Disney. And I witnessed this at ComEd Exelon.
Yeah, I'm not questioning what you're saying. You asked me, had anyone expressed concern to me about that? Until you just said it, no, nobody has. And I have nothing about it in the book. But that, you know, I'm sure I left a lot of stuff out. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking Ted Koppel and Chris Geary for amazing conversation.
Thank you, Chris.
If you all wouldn't mind just holding your seats for a moment, so Mr. Koppel will go out and he'll be signing books at the table in the back. It is great to hear your voice again.
Thank you.
It was a fascinating conversation. Thanks.
All right.
Sleeper cells in the Chinese grid and the Russian grid.
Absolutely. Let's separate the notion of these time bombs and the sleeper cells. Really two different things. The time bombs, I don't want to leave you with the impression that any high school hacker can get into the grid. It is enormously complex. And intelligence agencies from our adversaries have been spending years mapping the grid so that they can determine how to do maximum damage. We know, I say, because the former chief scientist of the NSA told me this, as did Keith Alexander, his boss, who was the director of NSA, we know that the Russians are in the grid, we know that the Chinese are in the grid. That's actually not as alarming as you may think, because we have so many interlocking relationships with both the Chinese and the Russians that it is most unlikely that they will hit the key. It would, after all, be nothing less than an act of war. The problem is, and Chris made reference to it a moment ago, these teams of, in effect, agents who are skilled in cyber warfare, who have been dispersed by the Russian government, quite literally all around the world, who are in a position to launch cyber attacks, have the knowledge, the wherewithal, simply waiting for a directive. Think about it for a moment. It's very, very difficult, bordering sometimes on the next to impossible, to determine the point of origin of a cyber attack. The initial indication appears to be it came from Ukraine. Then the NSA looks into it a little bit further and says, no, it actually looks like before Ukraine, it came from Buenos Aires. Wait a second. Before Buenos Aires, it came from Copenhagen. Before Copenhagen, it came from Johannesburg. Before Johannesburg, and this appears to be, we think we've tagged it now. The point of origin is Brooklyn. Really? Who did it? Who ordered it? You know, a president can respond to missiles that are coming from Russia or China. He knows the point of origin. The Chinese know, the Russians know that the president knows where the attack is coming from and that a counterattack is going to happen within a matter of minutes. That's what created mutual assured destruction, the balance of terror.
That doesn't work with cyber. Mutual assured destruction is not a disincentive for others.
Exactly. Quite the contrary. It is an incentive. I mean, one of the ironies of this nuclear deal we've made with Iran is that the great danger from Iran is not a nuclear attack. I mean, the Iranians would be absolutely insane to engage the United States in a nuclear war. They would lose that in a matter of hours. But cyber attacks originating in Iran, or at least ordered by Iran and originating elsewhere, that's something else again. So here's the curious situation. The ones who have the greatest capability, the Chinese and the Russians, least likely to do it because we have so many interlocking relations with them. Not so much with Iran. Their capability is almost equal to that of China and Russia. We don't have that many interlocking relationships with them. As you go down the capability scale, North Korea, not as capable as Iran, but capable of doing real damage. Do they have a lot to worry about? Think only of those photographs you've seen of the Korean Peninsula at night. Below the DMZ, lit up like a Christmas tree. Above the DMZ, effectively dark. They don't have an infrastructure. They are not vulnerable to attack. The paradox is that we, because we are such a dependent society on the internet, we are more vulnerable to cyber attack than probably any country in the world.
You also mentioned in your book that one of those players is Syria.
Yes.
And you go so far as to suggest that American foreign policy may have very well been impacted by our knowledge of the Syrian capabilities.
At the time that the president was considering the possibility of an attack on Syria, you remember when it was determined that they had chemical weapons and the president had warned this was a red line they must not cross. They crossed it. The president did nothing. George Cotter, again, the former chief scientist of the NSA, told me that at that time, there were Syrian cyber attacks launched against banks in New York. Definitive conclusions cannot be reached, but simply look at what was out there. The Syrians were clearly sending a message. We can cause you enormous damage. We can create huge upset in your financial markets. Better not launch those attacks against Syria. Was that the reason that we didn't? I don't know. But those, at least, are the facts that existed at the time.
So we've talked about these potential enemies so far, state actors, Syria, Iran, North Korea, China, Russia. We've just in the last week heard from our intelligence community pretty definitively that a Russian airliner was brought down by a bomb, presumably from ISIS. Are these non-state actors, the terrorist organizations, are these the kind of groups that could get the capability to take down the grid?
In short, yes. probably don't have the capability yet, although I was told by a former cyber advisor to the White House that it is his, that it's his belief that indeed organizations like ISIS, even if they themselves don't have the expertise, they have a couple of $1 billion. You can buy a lot of expertise for a couple of $1 billion. And the equipment that's needed to do this, unlike, again, I mean, what's so different about cyber warfare is you don't need an army, you don't need a navy, you don't need an air force, you don't need missiles. You need the knowledge to be able to launch an attack like this, and you need a laptop computer. It can be done by an individual anywhere in the world. Is it almost inevitable that ISIS, if it doesn't have the capability now, will get it at some time in the not too distant future? Apparently, yes. And when you talk about interlocking interests, we in ISIS have none. So there are no inhibitions on a group like ISIS to do something like this. They, after all, their strategy, if it can be described as such, is nothing more or less than inflicting pain and causing damage. That would inflict a lot of pain. That would cause a lot of damage.
You've got a lot of scary quotes in this book, enough to keep people up late at night. But one of the scariest ones, to me anyway, came from the former director of national intelligence. We used to call him the CIA director, Mike McConnell. And it was relayed to you from Jay Rockefeller, the former chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. And the quote was from, this is from Mike McConnell, "For the record, if we were attacked, we would lose." Does your reporting convince you that that sentiment is pretty well shared by the intelligence community?
Yes, and let me, you know, let me presume to explain what I think Director McConnell was talking about. I made reference to it or an allusion to it a moment ago. We are so dependent on the internet in this country, as dependent as any great power out there, probably more dependent than most. The internet was never designed to be defended. The people who created the internet in the first place assumed, as one military intelligence officer told me, that it was going to be used by professors to exchange good ideas. The notion that someday you would have to defend the internet against a hacking attack, when it was created, nobody even knew what a hacking attack was. It was not a concept that was out there. So here we are in a situation where, arguably, because of our dependence on the internet and because of the many, many uses to which we put it, we're more vulnerable than anybody else out there. Do we have a terrific cyber offensive capability? Yes, we do. And if we know who has attacked us, and if they also are vulnerable to cyber attack, we can do a hell of a job.
Well, one of the ironies that you point out is that as the United States was the first country to launch a nuclear attack, we were also the first nation to launch a very sophisticated cyber attack.
On the Iranians. We and the Israelis, and ironically, I'm told, the reason that we collaborated with the Israelis on launching the cyber attack is we felt that Israel was dangerously close to launching an offensive attack against Iran, that the Israelis were dangerously close to attacking Iran because of its growing nuclear capability. To stop Israel or to discourage Israel from doing that, our NSA and the Israeli equivalent collaborated on developing a program called Stuxnet. Stuxnet was used, I always have trouble, what are the spinning?
Centrifuges.
The centrifuges, thank you. Stuxnet was developed, those centrifuges which spin the nuclear fuel have to spin at precisely the right number of revolutions per minute or per second. Let's say it's 2,000 revolutions a minute. If they spin too fast or spin too slow, you throw the whole program off kilter. We and the Israelis managed to implant a virus in the program that caused these centrifuges to spin out of control. What we also did that is close to genius, but was apparently borrowed from the Hollywood movie Ocean's 11.
We faked them out, right?
Faked them out. Created a video that somehow we managed to implant in the Natanz control room. It showed the spinning going exactly as intended, so that the Iranian technicians sitting at the control board would be looking up and saying, everything okay here?
No right? Bank heist.
Right? Meanwhile, the centrifuges were spinning out of control. The Iranian program was set back about a year and a half or 2 years, and Iran did respond. The point that Chris is making is we fired the first shot in real cyber war.
And Iran didn't retaliate against us.
They didn't retaliate against us or against the Israelis, because apparently they didn't want this to turn into an escalating cyber war. They did retaliate against Aramco.
Which is
an Arab-American oil company based in Saudi Arabia. And what they did is they launched a cyber attack, a hacking attack, and knocked out 30,000 computers. In other words, every computer that Aramco was using showed a video of a burning American flag. But they were, as one officer told me, essentially 30,000 bricks. They were useless. So that was the first cyber battle, if you will. We knocked their centrifuges off balance. They came back at Aramco. And here we are now confronting all kinds of incredible potential for cyber war being raised several notches.
Help us understand why it is that our electrical grid is so vulnerable. What is it about? Why isn't it better protected?
The power grid used to be made up of relatively few companies, and they were vertically integrated, which means that the companies would generate the power, they would transmit the power across the country, and then they would download the power at local places to our places of business and our residences. A number of years ago, the electric power industry was deregulated. There are now 3,200 electric power companies out there. In order for them to be able to interact with one another, in order for them to be able to function, they require the internet. They require what are called SCADA systems, supervisory control and data acquisition. I'm gonna bore you for a minute or so with a little bit of wonkiness here, but you need to understand how the system works. Imagine a giant balloon that has 1,000 valves. 500 of those valves take air in, 500 of those valves release air out. As long as the amount of air coming in and the amount of air going out is exactly the same, the balloon remains perfectly inflated. Too much air, balloon bursts. Too little air, balloon collapses. Our power grid depends upon maintaining a perfect balance between the amount of electricity that is generated and the amount of electricity that is used. There is only one operating system, and that is the internet, that is capable of maintaining that excruciatingly fine balance among 3,200 different companies. That's that SCADA system that I was talking about a moment ago. If a hacker can somehow get into that SCADA system and throw it out of balance so that more power is being generated, let's say, than is being used, you would get a cascading effect that can take out all or part of a grid.
What kind of power or control or authority does the federal government have over these 3,000 plus little power companies?
Yeah, surprisingly little. Let me just tell you that FERC, which is the federal agency that allegedly has power over the power industry, FERC has to propose legislation or rules to the power industry. The power industry then gets to vote on whether it wants to accept those regulations.
Funny how that works.
Funny how that works. Unless 60% of the power industry approves the regulations, they don't go into effect. So here we have an industry that has the right to determine which regulations on its operation it is prepared to accept. This is hardly the federal government controlling the power industry. It's the power industry controlling what the federal government can enforce. Having said that, it also, at the delivery point, again, gets a little wonky here, but power, when it's generated, you have these step-up transformers which increase the wattage, or the voltage rather, so that the electricity is sent across the country at high speeds. Then when it gets to its location, there are step-down transformers that enable the electricity to be delivered to your home, to your place of business. There is no federal regulation, none, that is operative from that final point where the electricity is stepped down and actually delivered to your home. Forget about your home for a moment. The electricity that is delivered to the CIA is not under federal regulations. The electricity that is delivered to the NSA is not under federal regulations. It's an incredible situation, but part of our biggest problem is our own system.
And as, much as the intelligence officials seemed to have a consensus on the dangers here, from what I gather with your interviews with the power company executives,
right,
there are quite a few who think that these concerns are overblown.
Yes, they do. And I mean, Chris, you and I have been reporters all our lives. At a certain point, you come to a, forgive me, it's, we learned to separate shit from shinola. And I must tell you that in the final analysis, I came, we all have to reach a conclusion at some point or another. When you read the book or when you get other information on the subject, you may reach a different conclusion. I am convinced that this can happen, and I am more or less convinced that at some point or another, it's going to happen in one form or another.
It seems from your reporting that in some form, it already has happened. I mean, you cite a very interesting attack on a substation that serves San Jose, California,
yes,
the Silicon Valley, which requires enormous power. 2013, a substation was taken out by an armed group. And
yes,
this is something that, although the Wall Street Journal has done a fair amount of reporting, very little is known about this.
To this day, the FBI doesn't know exactly who was responsible. This has nothing to do, parenthetically, with cyber war. What happened here is that a group of people, we don't know how many, went to the Metcalf substation, a substation of PG&E, and using what a SEAL team later determined was AK-47s, shot out 17 or 19 large power transformers. These large power transformers are among the most vulnerable things we have in our electric power system. There are thousands of them, maybe tens of thousands, but they are gigantic, 400,000 to 600,000 pounds each. Each one costs about $10 million, and each one is custom made, so that you cannot just take a large power transformer that Chris happens to own. I mean, he can't just send it over to my power company and say, here, I understand yours were shot out, use mine. They're not interchangeable. And here's the worst news of all. Very few of them are made here in the United States. They're almost all made, about 75 or 80% of them, are made overseas. How long does it take from the time that you order a new large power transformer until delivery? 1 to 2 years, right? So here is a situation where 17 of these large power transformers were shot out. The only conclusion that the FBI has reached to date is that this may have been a...
Dry run?
I'm sorry?
A dry run.
It may have been an exercise. Because
but they have no clue who did it.
I'm sorry?
They have no clue.
Not a clue.
Wow.
Not a clue. And it's been 2.5 years. And we still don't know who did it. If you knocked out enough of these transformers over a fairly wide geographic area, they were able to get online again very quickly because they were able to transfer power to another generating station nearby. As it was, this particular station was knocked out, I think it was 17 days. Not too terrible. And indeed, the power companies will say, see, we were able to get back online again. But if this was only a dry run, and if the real operation that someone is planning is to hit half a dozen of these substations at the same time, again, the impact could be devastating.
What about the giant companies in the Silicon Valley, Apple, Google, Facebook? Do they have their own generation, or do they rely on this grid?
They rely on the grid. I'm sure they have their own emergency generators. And again, with emergency generators, you can keep power going for quite a while. I have two emergency generators at my home. They operate on natural gas, which comes in automatic. One little problem. The natural gas comes from Texas. It is driven through pipes, right, by motors.
Forced air, yeah.
Those motors are run on, they're run by electricity. So my emergency power generators are probably going to shut down at some point, really fairly soon. After a cyber attack like this. On the other hand, I could have one operating on diesel fuel, but then I'd have to bury a 1,000-gallon tank to be sure that I have enough diesel fuel. There are major problems. I mean, what happened after Superstorm Sandy in New York? The gas stations had plenty of gas, plenty of gasoline. It was all down there in those tanks. Unfortunately, they didn't have any emergency generators, and the power was out, so they couldn't pump the gas. That's a problem. So what the state of New York had to do was to provide generators to all of these gas stations. I went to my local gas station in Potomac, Maryland. I've known the owner for 40 years. I said, Mike, do you have an emergency generator? And he said, no. I said, why not? He said, well, it costs $40,000. I'm not going to spend $40,000 on that. I said, but if the power goes out, you won't be able to pump gas. He said, well, I'll be out of work. That's it. But my lease is only good for another 7 years, and I cannot afford to spend $40,000. I'll never make that $40,000 back over the next 7 years. So he's rolling the dice that it's not going to happen.
I remember one day in Washington, might have been 2007, 2008, when power went out on the East Coast. You were called in and you were like iron pants that day. You were on the air for ABC News for, eight or 10 hours.
Yeah.
35 million people were without electricity for several days. Is that kind of a taste of what we might expect, what the East Coast saw in those few days?
Yeah. Here's something else you may want to think about. So let's say the power goes out in New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, Delaware. Now you've got several tens of millions of people without power. There is an inadequate food supply because, for example, the state of New York, I talked to the head of Homeland Security for the state of New York, and I said, how much emergency food do you have? Oh, he said, we have 25 million MREs. Wow, 25 million. I said, now, city of New York alone, five boroughs, you've had 8 million people, so 8 into 25, you got about 3 meals per person, right? So after 2 or 3 days, you're out of food. He said, right. I said, what do you do then? He said, then we're in deep trouble. Here's the problem. You got tens of millions of people without electricity, without light, without power, without the capability to turn on a tap and get water, without the ability to flush your toilet. So in a place like New York or Chicago, how long do you think it's going to be before the inability to get rid of human waste becomes a health problem? And people say, I know what I'll do. I'm going to hop in my car, and I'm going to drive to the nearest state where the lights are still on. You are assuming that you will be welcome. We're all Americans, right? You may not be. I spoke to an official of one state that is a rural state, only a few hours' drive from Washington, who told me that the governor had a, in effect, they did sort of a war game. And they have told the National Guard, the state police, the local sheriff's departments, that what they're going to be doing in the event of something like this and tens of thousands of refugees coming from Washington, they will be handed a bottle of water, a sandwich, and a map. And the map will show them where the nearest gas station is. And they will be told, I'm terribly sorry, we do not have the infrastructure to support tens of thousands of refugees.
Even before we get to that point, in a city like Chicago or New York, where a lot of people like me live in high rises, the elevators are going to go up.
Yes. The first thing that will happen, the first thing that does happen when the power goes out, the first thing that happened when Superstorm Sandy hit is the emergency personnel. Their first job is getting everybody out of stalled elevators, right? That's the easy part. From there on in, it gets really nasty. Remember, we are a nation of 300 million guns. At a time like this, when people are hungry, and folks in rural areas may have a freezer full of venison or not, but, you know, it's more likely that people in the countryside are simply more accustomed to handling bad weather, being able to get through. And I'm not suggesting that you have to have MREs or freeze-dried food. You know, if you live in a place where space is not an issue, a 50-pound sack of rice and a 50-pound sack of black beans will do you very nicely.
But in the meantime, what's the federal plan? When you talk to Homeland Security, you talk to FEMA, they certainly have thought this through, right? They've got a plan?
They do not. They have plans for every natural disaster under the sun. They have plans for earthquakes, they have plans for hurricanes, they have plans for snowstorms, blizzards, drought. They have all kinds of plans. But every one of those plans, with the possible exception of the earthquake, involves the recommendation that we have a 2 to 3 day supply of food and water, that we have extra medicine that will take us over that 2 to 3 day period, that we have a radio with fresh batteries, a flashlight, and a plan so that if the family is separated when the crisis hits, that we'll know where to meet them.
A couple of granola bars and we're all set.
But
if the federal government...
Well, let me just finish, Chris, because, you know, when I pressed the current Secretary of Homeland Security and said, that's fine, but that's 2 or 3 days. If you're dealing with a cyber attack, we're talking about weeks, maybe months. What is the plan? And he and I did not hit it off. And he was pointing over his shoulder to a shelf that had several white binders on it. And he said, I'm sure there's a plan up there somewhere. If the plan is that they're only going to tell us about it after the power goes out, think about it for a moment. That's sort of counterintuitive, isn't it? I mean, first of all, the time to tell us about it is when all of our means of communication are still functioning. Those cell phones we use every day, they're going to be out of power in a day and a half. Mine is usually shot after one day. The phones, not going to be working. Your banks, going to be closed down. Cash machines, not functioning. And food, running out.
during Katrina, you famously had Michael Brown, the head of FEMA, on the show. I was down in New Orleans basically reporting on bodies being stacked up at the convention center. And Brown told you everything was hunky-dory. And Bush, I think, said something like, attaboy, Brownie, or something like that.
Nice job, Brownie.
Yeah. But at any rate, do you, based on your reporting, have any confidence that should we experience an attack like this, that FEMA is any better equipped to handle it than they were at Katrina?
Much better. I mean, first of all, the current administrator of FEMA is a man by the name of Craig Fugate. Fugate is a terrific disaster specialist. And when I asked Fugate, what's the plan? He was very candid about it. He said, I mean, first of all, we would get emergency generators. You've got to get water in. You've got to get emergency generators into as many of these cities as you can, primarily for the purpose of keeping the toilets flushing so that we don't have the health crisis of human waste building up. But when I said, what would you do in the event of a cyber attack where we're talking about not a few days, but weeks or months without power? And he said, effectively, my job and FEMA's job is going to be keeping the number of dead down to a manageable level. That was about as honest an answer as I got from any official in government.
So if the government is really not prepared, you did find somebody who is.
The Mormons. The Mormons are prepared. And in large measure, they are prepared because the Mormons have a history. In fact, those of you here in Illinois may remember that there was a Mormon city not too far from here that in the middle of the 19th century was effectively the size of Chicago. Mormons had a huge presence here in Illinois at one point. They also previously had a presence in Missouri and a presence in Pennsylvania and a presence in New York State where the religion began. But they kept being driven from one state to another. And it was sort of ingrained in Mormon culture that you have to be prepared for bad times. You have to be prepared for disaster. Essentially, all Mormon families are encouraged to have a 3 to 6 month supply of food at home. And many, if not most, do. The Mormon church as a whole, the institution, has created an absolutely mind-boggling backlog and continual production of food and necessary supplies. I spent 3 days out in Salt Lake City because they insisted the only way I could really understand what they've got is to come out and look at it. And they were right. It was the right thing to do. The Mormons are prepared. I spent 3 chapters in the book on the Mormons because I think all of us can learn something.
Are they going to help us out? Are they going to share a sandwich?
You know something? It's fascinating because I raised that question.
Gay, if you're gay?
Huh?
What if you're gay?
I raised the question with individual Mormon families and got some heartbreaking responses. I mean, people saying, I remember one woman in Cody, Wyoming, saying to me, if hungry people came to my door and I have food, I have to share it. And I turned to her husband and he said, look, this is, we believe that this is not the only life there is. We believe that there is a life with Heavenly Father, and I'm going to be judged on how I respond to situations like that here and now. When I tried to get leadership in the Mormon church to tell me what they would do, because it is maybe not as well known now as it will be when people read the book, but the understanding that Mormons have these warehouses, collections of warehouses, that would put Walmart and Costco to shame, enough food and enough materiel to maintain probably most, if not all, of the 6 million Mormons in this country. Would they share it with the rest of us? At that point, my guess is Probably not.
So the lessons, you said that you've got a generator, right? You've got water. What else have you done? Have you become what they call, or you call, a prepper?
A prepper. I mean, it's not a term that I came up with. Preppers, we're familiar with survivalists. We're familiar with the image of people who've built themselves a bunker, who have a machine gun sort of standing on the sandbags, and who are waiting for the black UN helicopters to show up. These folks are not the preppers. The preppers, for the most part, are sensible men and women who simply are concerned that the federal government is not going to take care of them in the event of an emergency. And some of them have gone to, there are programs on television that are really silly, and they are there more for the entertainment than anything else, focusing on preppers. Most preppers that I've met tend to be fairly sensible people who have prepared for at least a few weeks without any kind of food that they can buy from the store or expecting any help from the government.
One conservative website called Newsbusters was taking a little fun at your expense.
And sure.
Recent headline: has Ted Koppel become a right-wing survivalist?
I saw that.
And great quote here: it now appears that Ted Koppel is wearing a tinfoil hat, I don't see it here, because he is warning us about a possible apocalyptic catastrophe.
Yeah.
So you're not wearing the hat, but are you trying to scare us here?
Yes. I think there are times when, in the final analysis, all of us, Chris, you've had occasion to make decisions like this also. In our system of government, in our culture, we at least used to believe, even though it may be slipping a little bit, that the job of the media is to tell us, in addition to the wonderful things that are going on, to warn us about bad things that may be developing. I would feel an awful lot worse if I decided, no, this is going to cause too much upset. I'm not going to tell people what I've learned. How would I feel a few months from now if something like this happens and I knew by alerting people I could have saved even a few lives? It's not my job, ultimately, to tell you whether to act on what I'm telling you or not act on what I'm telling you. My job is to say, look, I did a year and a half of reporting and writing. I talked to the smartest people I could find who know as much about this subject as I could possibly gather. And my conclusion is it's very likely that this is going to happen. Now, you do whatever you want. Ironically, to use the term right-wing survivalist, this is an issue that should not divide us on a partisan basis. This is not a conservative issue. This is not a liberal issue. Democrats and Republicans ought to be responding to this in the same fashion. If you don't believe it, that's fine. That's your option.
That raises a point that I want to end on before I invite the audience to come in, and that is you write somewhat wistfully in your book about a different era when journalism and both parties in Washington shared what you had some shared civic values. That's obviously disintegrated with the partisanship that we've seen in the media and in Washington. My final question for you is, what does the loss of those shared values mean for any meaningful discussion on an issue like this, let alone action?
It's devastating. It's devastating. The late, great U.S. Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan used to say, everyone is entitled to his own opinion. He's not entitled to his own facts. We live in an era in which people quite literally are making up their own facts. People on the right are doing it. People on the left are doing it. I make reference in the book to the fact that in a survey that was conducted among a lot of people, more than 1,000 people, the question was asked, And it was put this way. Are you sure that President Obama was born outside the United States? And I believe it was 37% of the respondents said yes. I'm sure he was born outside the United States. Give me a break. I mean, some things are just stupid. Some things are just insane. But because we have so much partisanship in our media these days, and particularly on the web, because there are so many blogs out there that take a position that is extreme in one direction or another, and I'm not pointing the fingers at either the right or the left, to a certain degree, they're equally culpable. We have to get back to a point in this country where objectivity and seeking the facts is considered a worthwhile career. And I realize that, Rupert Murdoch, when he created Fox, was responding to a perception that people like Chris and me were part of a media that, for the most part, was too liberal, and that there was a need for a conservative counterbalancing. And Fox has certainly done that. But I think we've gone too far. We need to get back to a day when we can actually, how wistful, you talk about wistfulness. Think about the fact that Walter Cronkite at one point was the most trusted man in America. Imagine the suggestion that a journalist today would be accepted by people on the right and people on the left as being the most trusted man or woman in America. Ain't gonna happen, not anymore. But that's our loss.
On that eloquent note, I would like to invite some questioners, and the first few would like from students from UFC, so please come on up to
the
microphone.
There's a microphone over there if you wanna go to it.
Hi, thank you for coming today. It seemed like a lot of your solutions that you were talking about were for mitigating the results of this problem. Is there truly no chance at prevention? Are government officials looking towards more analog backup methods if a cyber attack were to occur? Or is it more of, we just need to prepare for ourselves?
No, it's a terrific question. Unfortunately, because of the deregulation of the power industry, analog isn't going to work anymore. You need the internet to maintain that exquisite balance I was talking about with production of electricity and consumption of electricity. And because there are now 3,200 individual companies, and they all have to be connected, and decisions need to be made at the speed of light as to how much electricity to bring in and how much electricity to send out, going back to the analog system is probably not an option. Not that I think the power industry would permit that to happen. Can we look forward to the development of more microgrids, for example, which are cropping up all over the United States? Yes, we can. Are there going to be options that smart people are working on? And there are, and I write about some of them in Lights Out. But can any of these measures be completed before something like this is going to happen? Almost certainly not.
Great question.
You mentioned before that if our country is faced with a cyber attack, we have the potential to launch a retaliatory cyber attack if you know where it came from.
Yeah.
But do you ever envision that if we're faced with a cyber attack that might lead to actual physical warfare?
I'm sorry?
That if we're faced with a cyber attack, it might lead to an actual physical warfare?
Oh, of course. Of course. Absolutely. But, whether the response comes in the form of a cyber counterattack, or whether we send the Marines, or whether we launch a nuclear missile, you still have to know where the attack came from. And the great danger in cyber warfare is we almost certainly will not know that immediately, and it may be weeks or months before we can say with certainty. Put yourself in the position of the president, whoever that happens to be, who looks at the consequences of this attack and asks his intelligence people, can you tell me where it came from? And they're saying, well, we can say with 37% certainty that it came from the Russians were behind it. And if you're the president, you're going to say, wait a second, you expect me to launch a counterattack based on 37% certainty? I can't do that.
Hello, thank you for coming. I'm a student at the Harris School, and I'm taking a class in cybersecurity right now, and we've learned about something called the 20 critical controls. And apparently a lot of cyber issues come down to very easy hacks that are kind of widespread and we could control if we just had better hygiene in most of our systems. So I'm wondering, in terms of the systems that provide access to the systems that are providing us energy, the grid, so all of the connected places where a hack could come from, do you think that there's a solution in kind of optimizing all of those entry points with just basic hygiene, which would probably account for like 80% of the possibility of getting it hacked? Or is that like infeasible because of political and other reasons?
No. It's a terrific question. And think about the word you're using, hygiene. And then think about how many words in cybersecurity are borrowed from medicine. So we talk about a virus. We talk about exercising hygiene. Here's one of the problems. The big companies, the ones with lots of money, set up Sony Pictures, for example, in one Wall Street Journal story. They came to the conclusion Sony Pictures had 43 firewalls. 42 of them were run by outside companies. One of them, the outside company, had been dropped, and Sony had taken over the firewall itself. The conclusion that the Wall Street Journal reached was that that was the point of entry. Imagine you've got these power companies that have every possible cybersecurity measure that money can buy. Jamie Dimon, the head of J.P. Morgan, J.P. Morgan Chase, told me that his company, by this time, has probably spent close to $1 billion on cybersecurity. Here's the problem. Some guy or gal takes their thumb drive home and plugs it into his or her personal computer. And it is infected, right? He takes that thumb drive back to work.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another in the Institute of Politics speaker series events tonight. My name is Steve Edwards. I'm the executive director here, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's conversation featuring former ABC News Nightline anchor Ted Koppel in conversation with his ABC News colleague and former Nightline correspondent Chris Bury, who's based here in Chicago, and we're thrilled to have both of them here tonight with us for a conversation about Ted's latest book. It's called Lights Out, A Cyber Attack, A Nation Unprepared, Surviving the Aftermath. Books will be on sale out here in the lobby in the immediate aftermath, and Ted has been kind enough to agree to sign those books. So we encourage you, if you're interested, to pick up a copy, to please do so after the conclusion of tonight's conversation. As I mentioned, our speaker series goes on throughout the academic year. We have a number of upcoming events this week and next. We have Garry Kasparov coming up on Thursday at noon, talking about politics inside Russia and Putin from his perspective. That'll be at noon on Thursday. Next week, we have a series of events, including a fascinating conversation taking us inside Iranian culture and politics, featuring our very own Marvin Zonis from the university, who's with us here tonight. You'll want to be sure to mark that conversation on your calendar for next Thursday. You can find out about all of these events, as I've mentioned before, on our website. The URL is politics.uchicago.edu. And for students in the audience who are looking for a study break tonight, after tonight's event, we invite the students to come over to the IOP House on Woodlawn for our debate watch party for tonight's Republican presidential debate. So, lots going on at the IOP, and here to officially kick off tonight's program is Maggie Loughran. And Maggie is a student from Pelham, New York. She's here at the university and has most recently been active with the IOP through our Iowa Project. And for those of you who aren't aware of the Iowa Project, it's a program that we supported and created this summer that sent nearly 20 University of Chicago students to Iowa. Half of them were working in the world of politics, on campaigns and field organizations, consulting firms. The other half spent time working for news organizations on the ground. Maggie spent her time at CNN over the course of the summer in the thick of the presidential campaign, and she's returning there along with some other students that we're taking back to Iowa on Saturday for the Des Moines Register-sponsored presidential debate, where they'll be working behind the scenes producing that event. So please join me in welcoming Maggie to the podium to get us started tonight. Maggie?
Good evening, everyone. Ted Koppel is best known for his reign as anchor and managing editor of ABC News' Nightline from 1980 to 2005. His reporting for television's first late-night news program has earned him every major broadcasting award, including 42 Emmys and 8 Peabodys. After leaving ABC, Koppel served as managing editor of the Discovery Channel until 2008. He is currently a senior news analyst for NPR, a contributing analyst to BBC World News America, and a special correspondent for Rock Center. Koppel is also the author of a New York Times bestseller, Off Camera, Private Thoughts Made Public. In his most recent book, Lights Out, A Cyberattack, A Nation Unprepared, Surviving the Aftermath, Koppel explores the implications of what he believes to be an inevitable cyberattack on one of America's three power grids. The federal government may be equipped to handle natural disasters, but it has no plan for the devastation that would result from an extended blackout. How should we prepare, and what can we do to prevent this unique threat to our time? Mr. Koppel will be discussing his book with Chris Bury, a fellow veteran of ABC News. Bury joined ABC in 1982 as a general assignment correspondent based in Chicago. In 1993, he began working as a correspondent on Nightline, where he also served as Mr. Koppel's principal substitute at the anchor desk. Bury is the winner of 6 Emmys and 2 Peabody Awards, and is now a correspondent for Al Jazeera America's America Tonight, host of In the Loop on WYCC here in Chicago, and is the journalist in residence at DePaul University. So with that, Mr. Koppel and Mr. Bury.
Thank you very much. You know, I've been waiting many years to get Koppel right where I want him, answering questions. But welcome to Chicago, my hometown and the University of Chicago, and thanks everybody for coming out tonight. Your visit is very timely. This is a relic of the 20th century called a newspaper. And on the front page of the Wall Street Journal today is this story. Dateline Kiev, Ukraine. 3 days before Ukraine's presidential vote last year, employees at the National Election Commission arrived at work to find their dowdy Soviet headquarters transformed into the front lines of the hottest cyber wars. Software was destroyed, hard drives were fried, router settings were undone, even the main backup was ruined. Is this the kind of attack that national security officials are worried could take out our power grid or part of it?
Well, it's the kind of cyber war, I think, for openness, Chris, we ought to point out that cyber war is already underway. We do it to them, they do it to us, but there are certain restraints. In other words, when the Chinese government vacuums up 22.1 million records, personnel records, of American officials who work for the Pentagon, who work for the CIA, who work for the FBI, there are several complications. One is, in this day and age, it's always been considered standard operating procedure. We spy on them, they spy on us. Cyber espionage takes it to a whole new level. If you think about 22 million records, I mean, the Chinese intelligence agencies can spend the next few years combing through those records with consequences that we cannot even foresee. The kind of attack that the Wall Street Journal is talking about in Ukraine, this kind of thing has been going on already for for years. What I'm talking about is a cyber attack against infrastructure, a cyber attack that could affect tens of millions of people for a period of months, if not longer.
But based on your reporting, it seems clear from your book that the national security officials believe that this is a matter of when and not if.
Exactly. In fact, that's a line that a man I came to know when I was embedded with the U.S. forces during the invasion of Iraq, he is now the commander of CENTCOM, four-star general Lloyd Austin, who said exactly that. It's not a question of if, it's only a question of when. One of the reasons that I started doing this book in the first place, Chris, is because I didn't see people paying a whole lot of attention when the president mentioned the danger of a cyber attack on our infrastructure, as he did not once, but twice during successive State of the Union speeches. I didn't see a whole lot of coverage after Leon Panetta said in 2013 in a public speech that he thought we were facing a cyber Pearl Harbor. Now, to the older members of this audience, calling anything a Pearl Harbor has a resonance that hardly any other expression has. I didn't see a whole lot of coverage after Janet Napolitano, who stepped down after nearly 5 years as Secretary of Homeland Security, warned about the danger of a cyber attack on the grid. So initially, my reaction was just one that you and I have had many times. You know, we smell a story there. We don't know exactly what's going to turn out or how we're going to, you know, how the story is going to evolve. But my first goal was just to establish, is this in fact a reality? And I interviewed about 65 people, and while there were a few, really only very few, who said, no, they don't think it's going to happen, the vast majority of people whom I respect said, yes, it is. In fact, Mike Rogers, Admiral Mike Rogers, who is the current director of the NSA, just told a Wall Street Journal conference about 2 weeks ago that it is inevitable, in his opinion, that there will be a cyber attack on our infrastructure.
And even if that isn't scary enough, one of the things that you report is that digital time bombs, sleeper cells, are already implanted in
right.
our grid.
Exactly. It is the conclusion of the NSA. And the NSA is probably the most competent cyber war organization in the world. As great as other nations' cyber offensive capabilities may be, ours are probably still greater. That should not come as a source of great comfort to you, however, because the problem with cyber attacks is that you don't necessarily know where they originated and who was behind them. Think back only to the cyber attack that the North Koreans launched on Sony Pictures.
Now, in revenge for that great movie, The Interview, with
exactly,
Seth Rogen film.
Seth Rogen yeah. film. So Seth Rogen makes this goofy movie about a North Korean dictator. It's a pretty silly movie, but obviously the North Korean dictator took offense.
No sense of humor, that guy.
No sense of humor. You would think that concluding the origin of that particular cyber attack would be a cinch. It took the FBI months before they could state with certainty, and I'm not mocking the FBI. I mean, the fact of the matter is, simply because it appears likely that the attack came from North Korea, that's not the kind of thing that a president can act on. They had to prove it. It took months. Now imagine a cyber attack that takes out one of our grids, or a part of one of our grids. We only have three. And as I say, tens of millions of people are affected. And when you talk about affected in this context, think of what it means to be without electricity. in our
I want to get to that in
yeah,
a minute.
Okay.
But first I want to go back to this sleeper cell, because you had a conversation in your reporting with George Cotter, who is the former chief scientist for the National Security Agency, the NSA. And he told you that China and Russia
already have.
Are already in the grid.
They're already in the grid, and they have what amount to time bombs, grenades, mines, however you want to refer to them, but cyber time bombs or cyber mines, which can, in effect, be activated with the stroke of a laptop key.
Is it fair to assume we have the same capability that we probably have?